Hello, and welcome to this presentation, Measuring Velocity Factor with a ZNH. In this short presentation, we'll explain how to measure the velocity factor of coaxial cables using a Rohde Schwarz ZNH series vector network analyzer. This presentation assumes a basic familiarity with distance default measurements and velocity factor. We'll provide a short review of each of these topics on the next few slides, but if you need or would like a more in-depth review, you might want to watch the presentations Understanding VNA's Distance Default Measurements and or Understanding Velocity Factor before beginning this presentation. Electrical signals propagate at the speed of light in a vacuum, but this speed is reduced when signals travel through matter. Coaxial cable, or coax, is the most common way of conducting radio frequency signals, particularly when longer distances are involved. For some applications and measurements, it's important to know the speed of propagation through a given coaxial cable, and the speed is normally quantified as the cable's velocity factor. As you may already know, coaxial cables consist of an inner conductor, an outer conductor, and an insulating or dielectric material between them. The velocity factor of a coaxial cable is a function of that cable's dielectric constant and is independent of the frequency of signals carried by the cable. Velocity factor is normally expressed as a fraction of the speed of light, and is therefore a unitless quantity between 0 and 1. Note that you may sometimes see velocity factor specified as a percentage as well. Most coaxial cables have a velocity factor between about 0.65 and 0.82, although in some cases you may see cables with a velocity factor as low as 0.5 or as high as 0.9. As mentioned a few moments ago, velocity factor is important for many different applications, and these include distance default measurements, tuning stubs, phase matching, navigational and direction finding systems, etc. One common method for measuring velocity factor is using a vector network analyzer, or VNA, to make a so-called distance default measurement. In DTF, the VNA sends signals into a cable to determine the distance to faults, which are points along the cable at which the impedance changes and causes signal reflections. The velocity factor of the cable must be known in order to make accurate distance default measurements. Conversely, if the cable length is known, a distance default measurement can be used to determine the velocity factor of a cable, and this is done by creating a large fault at the end of the cable. Leaving the end of a cable open or unterminated will cause all of the transmitted signal to be reflected from that point back towards the source. When making a DTF measurement, this will produce a large fault or spike on a plot of return loss versus distance, as seen on the right side of the graph below. The velocity factor of this cable is determined by placing a marker at the known or measured physical length of the cable. If we start with a velocity factor of 1, this marker will always be to the left of our end-of-cable fault. We then could change the velocity factor until the marker is on the end of the cable return loss peak. At this point, the length measured by the distance default measurement and the physical length of the cable will be the same, indicating that we are using the correct velocity factor for the cable under test. The steps in our procedure, therefore, are measuring the cable physical length, configuring the DTF measurement, creating a user cable model, running the DTF measurement, placing the marker, and adjusting velocity factor. In the remainder of this presentation, we'll provide a detailed explanation of how to perform each of these steps using the ZNH. In order to determine a cable's velocity factor with distance default, you must either know or measure the physical length of the cable. In this example, we'll be using a cable with a measured length of 1.2 meters. One end of this cable will be connected to the ZNH, and the other end will be left open or unterminated. Note that this is unlike normal DTF measurements, in which we terminate the far end of the cable under test. On the ZNH, distance default measurements are made in cable and antenna mode. To enter this mode, press the mode hard key on the front of the ZNH, and then choose cable and antenna from a list of available on-screen options. Next, press the measure hard key and choose measurement mode DTF in order to configure and run distance default measurements. We set the start and stop distance of the cable by pressing the frequency distance hard key, and then use start distance and stop distance. Stop distance should be set slightly longer than the measured or known physical cable length. If we leave the cable unterminated, a large fault or spike with close to 0 dB of return loss will be seen on the right side of the results. This peak corresponds to the end of the attached cable. We next need to configure a user-defined cable model by pressing the Measure Hard key and then Cable Config User Settings. Select Velocity Factor and enter a value of 1. Be sure that the user model is enabled, that is, checked, before exiting this menu. Now we need to place a marker using the Marker Hard key. After creating a new marker, manually enter the distance to match the measured length of the cable, here 1.2 meters. Since our manually configured velocity factor of 1 is clearly too high, this will cause the marker to be to the left of the end of cable fault. All that's required now is to adjust our manually configured velocity factor until the marker is on top of the end of cable fault. Going back to cable config, we start by changing the velocity factor to 0.6. This causes the DTF waveform to move such that our marker is now to the right of the end of cable fault. This means that our manually entered velocity factor of 0.6 is too low for this cable. If we increase velocity factor to 0.7, the marker is now closer to, but also slightly to the left of, the end of cable fault, meaning that our manually configured velocity factor is now too high. From this and the previous measurement, we know that this cable's velocity factor is between 0.6 and 0.7, and is closer to 0.7 than to 0.6. After a little more manual adjustment, we find that setting velocity factor to 0.693 causes the marker to fall directly on top of the end of cable fault, and this means that the velocity factor of the measured cable is 0.693. It's important to keep in mind that throughout this process, we've been adjusting the velocity factor. The marker remains stationary at the manually configured length value of 1.2 meters for this specific cable under test. Let's end with a brief summary. Velocity factor describes the propagation speed of signals within a coaxial cable, and is specified as the fraction of the speed of light in a vacuum. The Rohde Schwarz ZVH vector network analyzer can be used to measure velocity factor using its distance default functionality. In this case, the cable's physical length is first measured, and a marker is placed at this distance in the DTF application. When the DTF measurement is run on an open or unterminated cable, this will cause a large, near 0 dB fault at the open end of the cable. Velocity factor can then be determined by varying the user-defined velocity factor until this end of cable fault coincides with the marker placed at the known length of the cable. And although we've shown how to perform this measurement using the ZNH, this same methodology can be used with other network analyzers that support DTF measurements. This concludes our presentation, Measuring Velocity Factor with a ZNH. If you'd like to learn more about network analyzers, distance default measurements, or other related topics, please see the links in the video description. Thanks for watching.